A very good evening and welcome to this edition of On The Spot, this wonderful Thursday evening. My name is Simon Kasiate, standing in for Mr. Patrick Kamara, who is feeling a bit indisposed. This evening, we'll be discussing, well, like you may wish to guess, politics. Now, Her Excellency Edith Sempala spent most of her career in the coveted ambassadorial positions as she is well plugged into the international circuit of diplomacy. Mm-hmm. Once an admirer of the president, and we talk about President Museveni here, when she was in political exile in Sweden, she's now turned into an avowed critic. A consummate diplomat, today she's one of the key strategists of the former Premier Mambabazi's Go Forward campaign strategic team, who is seeking the presidency and currently heads the diplomacy and international desk. On the spot tonight, we'll have Ambassador Edith Sempala discussing with us what it is that one has driven her to this direction of Go Forward, if you may, but also importantly, what it feels like to be in the Go Forward camp and what there is behind the curtains as Go Forward sweeps across this country. And of course, discuss many other aspects, more so on the democratization of Uganda, given that, of course, in her own right, she's a human rights activist. We'll be I must admit, Your Excellency, that it's quite unusual to find an ambassador, even retired, dressed the way you are this evening. I must say you're looking cool in that white t-shirt and everything that comes with it. But good evening and welcome to the show.
Well, good evening, everyone. I am attired like this because I'm coming from the field. We're just coming from a breathtaking campaign, a rally in Ruero. It was wonderful.
It was wonderful. Of course, what would you say? Now, Your Excellency, today we are looking at your political dispensation in terms of now alignment. Many people will remember you for having served diligently this country as our ambassador to the United States of America. From there, I mean, before that, you were in the Nordic countries serving for over 10 years based in Copenhagen. And of course, later on, we see you go to the African Union. And just before we see you return back home, you work to the World Bank. And all this time, you were getting secondments and appointments from President Yoweri Museveni and the NRM government. You return only to come sounding critical drums against the same establishment you adored, loved, and for the most part, worked for. What went so wrong and when?
Simon, first and foremost, when I came back, I really intended to retire. I had no intention whatsoever to be involved in politics or even human rights activism because I did not believe that there was going to be any need for me to do that. But as I continued to observe what was going on, I realized that we were very quickly deteriorating. We are moving into a very dangerous and a very dangerous territory, which I did not believe we could be back in.
How about we go into the specifics? What exactly was going wrong? What was that straw that broke your back?
The human rights violations, the police brutality was just amazing. I started noticing something wrong really when I was still at the World Bank. I remember when I saw...
wait a minute, it had to be at the World Bank, not when you were ambassador in the US, not when you were ambassador in Sweden, not when you were ambassador of the African Union.
No.
But at the World Bank.
Yes.
That means it's about 2011.
Yes. It was after the elections. You remember the walk to work? And then I noticed, I saw Dr. Chizavesi's car being broken.
That infamous act where he was sprayed with a bit of tear gas.
He was fumigated.
Those are your words.
Yes. So I really realized that something was going wrong.
But Ambassador, with all due respect, something earlier had happened in 2005. The same Besigye had been clobbered off the streets of Kampala. The black members had stormed the High Court and the Kiboko squad was running amok on the streets of Kampala. How come then you were unable to raise the same things you are now able to see many years down the road? Would that be political honesty?
Yes, I think it is political honesty. As a matter of fact, I did not condone, I did not think it was right. Mm-hmm. But I think what was glaring in my mind was that the scene of seeing a policeman breaking into a car and then intentionally spraying Dr. Besigye. I think that is, in a way, what woke me up. Yes, I agree with you. I think things were already deteriorating. But I think it reached that stage that I realized that there was something wrong.
And when that eureka moment did manifest itself before you, what was your next step of action?
Well, I did complain, but I was...
You did, you didn't?
I did.
To whom?
I did to my friends. I did not do it publicly.
Mm-hmm. As any diplomat would do. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I did complain, and I complained to my friends in the United States, where I was in the United States at that time. But I did not raise any serious alarm. But obviously, I saw that there was something wrong. There was a serious departure from the original.
Complaining to friends, a close circuit of friends, or even the U.S., is not something typical of a guy or of somebody that has served in high-ranking diplomatic positions for a country whose government is in place and is making this kind of injustices according to its people. Mm. Possibly you'd have picked up the phone. Even President Museveni, I'm sure, would have picked it from you. Or there was a gentleman that was the prime minister at that time when that incident happened. Did you pick up the phone and call him and say, look, Mr. Prime Minister, I think your government is doing the wrong thing. Why did you choose to complain to other centers that possibly don't have a lot of sway in the way things are done here?
I did not complain to the prime minister, but I think I was not really concentrating on that. Mm-hmm. But obviously, because it irritated me, it rubbed me the wrong way. I just felt it, and I discussed it with friends. But I obviously didn't discuss it. I didn't raise it. I didn't raise it with journalists. I didn't raise it with anybody.
Why didn't but you?
I do not know why, but maybe the alarm. To me, remember, I was no longer serving the Uganda government. Mm-hmm. I was a private, I was an international civil servant, but I was concerned about Uganda because I'm Ugandan, but also because I served, and also because I was a human rights activist.
Ambassador Edith, away from that, what you consider blatant abuse of human rights by special law enforcement officers that should actually protect and serve, is there anything else that you felt was not going as was initially promised and planned? Because, I mean, you were in the kitchen of these whole things from the word go. You were in exile. You were leading the external wing of the NRM in Sweden. At least I've read that somewhere in your memoirs. Mm-hmm. What else other than that human rights bit? Was there no formal development taking place in this country for you to say, well, there may be some beatings on the streets, but there is some good roads being made. There may be some beatings on the streets, but maybe there's some good other social infrastructure on the ground, health services, education, and the like. What would you comment about the other amenities?
I think that, in fact, when I look around, I really don't see a lot of good. Mm-hmm. It's a very sorry story. When I've visited Murago since I came back, and I've seen women delivering babies in the corridor of Murago, and I was shocked because I thought that by now, at least, we would have been able to have reasonable services, health care services. I was also shocked.
Those are the lucky ones who deliver. Like we've been told by your candidate that 19 die every single day in childbirth-related.
Yes, 19 actually, I think it's an understatement because I think 19 is those who are known. But those who are not known, it could rise up to 50.
That's statistics for you. When I eat two chickens and you eat none, they will say, we ate a chicken each, because they divide the two chickens by two people.
Yeah, but you know very well that in the case of Uganda, there are so many women still delivering babies in at home.
So health services for you and other social infrastructure is not as should have been. Am I right, if I get you
right? It's far below standard. It really is very depressing. And I was in Kasese the other day, and I was told that they have medicine only sometimes, which means that diseases should also
wait when they have medicine.
Yes, wait until
Let's
they
put
have
a stick
medicine.
Right over there, and to use a direct translation from the local dialect and the local expression of Simba Wakatiao. So things are not as good as should have been.
Yes.
Human rights abused. Medical infrastructure, nothing much to write home about. And you return as Ambassador Edith Sempala, who has worked for this government for close to 30 years they have spent in power as an ambassador. You return here, and your first step into trying to ameliorate these problems is to align yourself to somebody who for all these years has been in the thick and thin of whatever malaise has afflicted this country politically. And now you're telling us, go forward.
I think
I'm trying hard to wrap my mind around it.
Yes, yes, Simon, I think you have to understand that if you see our constitution, all the power belongs to the president.
Does it?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
So unless, if you are
I thought
a
the
civil
same constitution
servant.
In Article 1 is clear and explicit. Power belongs to the people. Has the president become the people now?
Yes, he has, as a matter of fact. I think he has. By the way he behaves, by the way he's, I mean, the other day he was telling people that all the money belongs to him, and therefore, in order to get services, you really not need to be aligned to him. So that means that power belongs to him. But on a serious note, I think that if the constitution actually gives the power, the executive power, to the president, so unless if it is something that is not desirable by him, you would not be able to do it. I mean, you saw the other day.
Wait a minute, just before you give me that example.
Yes.
Let's go into the issue of human rights.
Yes.
When you gave an example of Dr. Kizza Besigye being, you know, kicked out of his car using methods that you described as horrendous, and I'm using words that would describe how you described this to me. And this was, the police will argue they were in line with the Public Order Management Bill, or Public Order Management Act for that matter. And we know that one of those that were in the inner sanctum of putting together such kind of what you may want to term as draconian rules is actually the gentleman that you are backing, the Right Honorable Mama Babazi, with the Public Order Management Bill. He was right in the center of it. How then would you put your weight behind such an individual and not perhaps the one who was affected and afflicted by these bad laws, who, interestingly, is also in the presidential race?
Okay, no, I do not believe that POMA, which is the law you are referring to, actually says that a policeman can tear gas or can break. I don't think that is what it says.
It may talk of reasonable force, and maybe in the circumstances that was a reasonable force. But be that as it may, Ambassador Sempala, again, I still come back to that. I mean, you are in the go forward camp.
Yes.
I don't have to reiterate that. The viewers can see clearly that you're well branded just as much.
Yes.
But the henchman of go forward, his hands are scattered across the very malaise that made you realize that this government was going astray. You still really want to blame it on President Museveni?
Yes, I do. I do, because he is the chief executive. All the power is vested in him. He is the one who was elected.
And I'm sure part of his power is the power of delegation. And for the most part, he did delegate to the Right Honorable Mama Babazi.
But, I mean, when he delegates, I think whatever you want to do, would you say that, you know, the IGP would be able to do or get away with whatever he wants to do if the president was not in favor of it?
So wait a minute. If in 2021,
yes,
the good old General Kaihura
mm-hmm.
chose to vie for the presidency,
yes,
and possibly resigns as IGP or gets fired disgracefully as the IGP in 2020, would you comfortably join his camp to lead the movement to replace President Museveni on the account of all that he has been doing at the helm of the police? I'm just using this for argument's sake to ask why it is Mbabazi and not Besigye that you're supporting.
Okay. I'm supporting Mbabazi because I know him for a very long time.
Uh-huh.
I know him as a man of integrity, a man of his word. I mean, anytime I needed advice as ambassador, I always went to him and to a few others, and I always thought I got very good advice. I knew him as a hardworking, as a man of excellence that wants always results. So my experience with him actually is the one which forced me or drew me to him. But I also believe that at the end of the day, Simon, we are going to need reconciliation in this country. I think our country has been so much fractured that we are going to need somebody who will be able to reconcile different sections of society, different tribes, different religions, different whatever. I believe that he is the right person. I think in my interview, I talked about seeing a Mandela in him, and I do believe that he possesses those qualities that I have been able to see in him when I was closely working
well,
with him.
Well, Ambassador Idi Sempala, mm-hmm. we will of course be looking at whether or not the absence of knowledge about the other presidential candidates perhaps couldn't be one of those reasons that you can blame for where Mbabazi signed. And of course, that parallel drawn between him and Nelson Mandela, you may need to substantiate it beyond their likeness in gray hair, especially in the later parts of Nelson Mandela. We'll be right back. Time is not on our side. We must take a short break, but when we return, of course, we'll be discussing more as to one, what got you there and how you are progressing in that Go Forward movement. We'll be right back. Welcome back, and talking about the Uganda Cranes, news coming in is that, of course, the Uganda Cranes has done what it does best, beat Togo 1-0 at home, and the momentum is set for the Sunday game. But back to On the Spot this evening, with me, Ambassador Edith Grace Sempala, former ambassador of Uganda to the Nordic countries, the United States of America, the African Union, and of course, a former employee of the World Bank, discussing with us what it is about her that after so many years of serving the NRM government in those various capacities, then now she decides it's high time she broke ranks with the establishment and support a different candidate who also shares a similarity with her. I mean, the same candidate has been as thick and thin of the NRM government together with President Museveni over the decades. And now they are calling on all of us to go forward. Now, before we went in for a break, Edith, mm-hmm. you'll pardon me for calling you Edith.
No, that is my name.
I think after one session of 10 minutes, we are now at first name basis.
Absolutely.
You did talk about the fact that this country has bled to such an extent that the next leader should be able to bring on the table reconciliation, and perhaps that's the reason why you've gone the direction of the Right Honorable Mama Mbabazi.
Yes.
But isn't that a superlative? Why are you saying this country requires reconciliation? Are we emanating from a situation of war? Are we coming from tribal clashes? Are we coming from this kind of situation that's almost akin to the Central African Republic or South Sudan, for that matter, or even Burundi? Why are you talking about reconciliation now? Shouldn't we be talking about the steady progress that has been around for the last 30 years?
Simon, I'm talking about reconciliation because I believe that our country has been fractured so much. You saw the other day when a woman, an FDC woman, was dragged on the road and stripped naked. I think that is I mean, that demonstrates, that shows that our society, our country is really breeding. I've never seen such a thing.
I mean, in that famous interview that you gave to one of the local newspapers, you in fact indeed likened President Museveni to the Idi Amin or even the Obote II era, saying that during Idi Amin's time, people never went through that level of dehumanization, and you in fact were unequivocal in saying President Museveni can be equated to Idi Amin. Wasn't that again another of those superlatives that he is akin to warmongering, saboteuring, and expressing a good point but with a bit of exaggeration?
Simon, it was not an exaggeration. Mm. During Idi Amin's time, I was in senior five in high school. I was coming from half term, and I had an incident where I was stopped at a roadblock and taken out of the bus and actually left there. I escaped by God's grace. So I was likening my experience.
Unripped.
Yes.
And undressed.
Yes.
And beaten.
Absolutely. So I was likening that experience with the experience of Fatuma. I don't know Fatuma, I've never met her, but what I saw was so, it felt like all women were being undressed. I felt being undressed myself. So I was likening her situation or comparing her situation to mine, and obviously her situation was much worse.
If it's about dropping names here, a lady like Barbara Ali Madi, if she's watching you on this evening, will tell you that she has gone through similar dehumanization at the hands of the same government at the time your candidate was prime minister. A lady like Ingrid Turinawe will tell you she's gone through a similar kind of maltreatment from the same government when your principal was prime minister. And one begs to ask the question, why have you gone that direction with the same guy that never spoke so passionately against these evils when they pervade, when he was in a situation when you could have done something about it? Do not tell me that the position of being Right Honorable Prime Minister, Leader of Government Business, before that a Super Minister, before that an Attorney General, before that Minister of Defense, before that an Executive Director of the External Security Organization, before that Confidant of the President, a lawyer in his own right, you cannot tell me that you are so disenfranchised that you could have done nothing, even so much as to say, I condemn these acts and we are sorry as a government.
I do believe that he may have raised it. I believe
our job
internally, I believe he raised it. And
has he told you just as much?
No, I have not asked, but knowing him, I know he raised it. I know he raised it, but because of the politics, he probably couldn't do anything about it. I mean, I know, for instance, my other, you know, mentor, Dr. Ruhakana Rugunda, is the prime minister. And these kind of things are happening. And in my heart, I have not raised it with him, but in my heart, I know that he doesn't agree and that most likely he has raised it. So, I think
you
it is important.
You have an incredible character to believe and trust so much humankind that indeed if Lucifer were human and he had done one good turn to you, you'd strongly defend them to the last, saying he's not the devil.
No, no, Simon.
And I'm not saying any of the guys that you defend is anything close to.
No, Simon. The people that I'm talking about, I know them. I've been with them for so many years. I've discussed, I know them, so I can say with certainty that I believe they have raised these issues. But these issues, remember, Simon, most of us, we supported this government believing that we are moving forward, believing that that the 10-point program that we started with was actually on course, until one by one we realize, at least let me speak for myself, I realized that something was wrong. One of the things that I could have I mean, vowed that President Museveni would never do was to be a sole candidate. I always told my friends it would not be possible.
Why so? Because you think President Museveni would not listen to the people if they demand just as much? I'm sure the President Museveni, you know, is a guy that listens to the people. If the people speak like they did in Jankwanzi, then he has no reason to say no.
It's more than people asking. Mm-hmm. I think that in democracy, there is competition. It's good to have, it is even healthy to have competition.
True that.
I think it would have been good for him to have the competition and win. And most likely he would have won. But I was completely surprised and shocked that he actually accepted, if not orchestrated.
I was just going to say, are you saying you orchestrated it? And then you dropped the word. So you're convinced that
yes.
President Museveni orchestrated this.
I believe
Can
so.
Can we? Oh, huh?
I believe so because.
Because you know him.
Because you know he normally
orchestrates things. Because you think he machinates things from the background.
Not really that. Mm. But I know that if he was against, if he didn't believe in it, he would have stopped it.
Let's get down to the issue that you mentioned, which in my view is the issue called issues.
Okay.
Your candidate is raising issues on the campaign trail.
Yes, yes.
But others are saying those are not issues at all.
Mm.
What does the Honorable Mavavazi know about poverty? The people he's speaking to know poverty more than he does. So describing to them the dire straits they're going through is possibly not enough. People want to be told how he will ameliorate the situation, how he will alleviate poverty.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start from there.
Yes.
How does Go Forward intend to make people richer than they already are?
The details are in the manifesto.
Just a tidbit.
Let me tell you some examples that I'm very familiar with, without divulging anything within the manifesto. Talk about jobs.
Mm.
Uganda fought for AGOA, the African Growth and Opportunity Act.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I led the African Diplomatic Corps in that effort.
Mm-hmm.
And our president, President Museveni, was the first to actually talk about it, to promote it in Congress. And we got it. But as we speak now, Uganda has not benefited, and yet many other countries, African countries, have benefited tremendously. Now, as you know, United States is a huge market. So, and a market for products, trade, means jobs. We have lost that opportunity. It just died. I think it is one of the opportunities that we have to revive and take advantage of because it is available.
And to use that very example, Edith, it therefore means that whatever has not gone right, you want to blame it on the individual in President Museveni. Yet I think, to be fair, you'd rather blame it on the government of President Museveni. And not until about 1 year ago. Again, sorry, I have to bring this up. I mean, it just keeps rearing its ugly head. But that's the truth of the matter. Until about 1 year ago, the Right Honorable Prime Minister, former Amama Mbabazi, who is your candidate as Go Forward, was in the inner sanctum of that government. If there must be any unachieved promises, any unrealized goals, he certainly should be able to take a bit of that blame. And I'm asking you, why would you want to hobnob with somebody who has had the track record of not delivering to the expectation of the people? How about if you possibly chose to pick somebody like Abed Wanka, perhaps who we have not tried, and try them and test them?
I wouldn't like to try somebody that is has not been tried.
So when you'd rather go with someone who you know has actually failed?
No, somebody whom I know was actually a super minister. So if he had the authority, I believe, because he was a super minister, I believe that he would deliver.
Tell me something.
Yes.
It looks like our biggest frustration is that there's so much power vested in the hands of the president. Mm. I mean, when you're the president, you are, and I'm sorry, I'm going to use this local dialect tongue, Kamalabiona, you are everything.
Yes.
Everything revolves around you. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's high time that constitutional dictate is looked into so that at the end of the day, you have President Edith Sempala, who does not enjoy every trapping of responsibility, but should have the responsibility to delegate, and if there must be anything that goes right, they take credit as a government. If something goes wrong, they take equal blame as a government, not as an individual. Because the same will be said about President Mbabazi when the time comes for evaluation. And I don't think that's a fair thing, because as a president, you work with a team.
Yes, Simon, if you are the appointing authority, mm-hmm. and your people are not delivering, what do? You sack them. Because
you saw what President Museveni did 1 year ago, Mbabazi can attest to that.
But he sacked him not because he had not delivered, but because of politics, because he thought he was competing with him. So that is not the reason why he should have sacked him. Mm. In fact, for the first time, we saw that President Museveni, all that he cares about is probably his power. Otherwise, if you are incompetent, if you are not delivering, that is fine.
As long as you're not a threat.
As long as you're not a threat.
If you are corrupt and the allegations of corruption around you and loss of integrity, as was the case with the Right Honorable Prime Minister Emeritus, years back, he was accused in almost every corruption scandal that ever bedeviled this country. But at that time, he seemed not to have any ambition to the extent of threatening President Museveni's power base. And President Museveni always turned not only a blind eye, a deaf ear, but also vehemently defended him. Am I right? Or these were just mere allegations that were otherwise aimed at tarnishing a good man's name?
You have, I think, answered my yourself.
No, how so?
Yeah, because I think all the cases that
someone would ask why him all the time.
All the cases that were brought up to against Right Honorable Amama Mbabazi were actually investigated, and there is a record that he was exonerated. So, but I also know that we have, of course, there are people who have a record of corruption. But there are also allegations, because if I want to tarnish you, Simon, the first thing is corruption. But good enough, he was cleared on all accounts. So we must therefore give him the benefit of doubt. I'm sure you have seen that record. And the record says he was clean. And as far as I'm concerned, my knowledge of him, I know him as a Mr. Clean.
Like I said earlier on, you have got an amazing ability to trust humankind.
Well, I trust until I'm betrayed.
Well, I'm sure after now, now, kindly say, Simon is a nice man. Of course, you and viewers will shortly be getting back to you to give you an opportunity to make your 2 pence, ask a question or make a comment on this program. And of course, it's an interesting insight getting a former ambassador who's worked in different portfolios at the appointment of President Museveni, now decades down the road, saying, I think you betrayed us and we're going into another direction. We'll take a short break. When we return, it's On The Spot. Welcome back. You're On The Spot on NTV. My name is Simon Kasiati, standing in for the regular host, Patrick Kamara. Ambassador Edith Sempala, you are Uganda's ambassador to Nordic countries, the United States of America, the African Union, and you worked at the World Bank. Today you are heading the international relations desk in the Go Forward campaign for the Right Honorable Amama Mbabazi. Let's get down to the election, or to the campaign for that matter, before we can call in or have one caller ask a question or make a comment. Mm-hmm. You've gone across this country, a few districts around about the city. The campaign is just 1 week old. What's your sense of the atmosphere within which the campaigns are being conducted? Are you finding some major bottlenecks that you think may impede the chances of your candidate from taking the presidency? Are you seeing certain things that are not in tandem with what a democratic election or electioneering process should be? How would you describe the campaign trail so far?
I think the campaign trail is, it has taken off very well. I think that the police, for a change,
the usual suspects,
I think is, doing its job well so far. Of course, we have seen some, whether crime preventers or whatever, trying to disrupt Right Honorable Amama Mbabazi's campaign. We saw it in Masaka and in Mukono. But we hope, I think Dr. Chigundu was talking against it the other day, which is very good. What I've noted is that people are really tired. They are tired of the conditions that they are living in, and they are expressing it, and they are ready for change. There is yearning for change.
Change. It's the picture of President Museveni. There's been a constant picture for a long time, Prime Minister. So you just want this change, not somebody totally out of the cabinet chat.
No.
Or anything other than President Museveni.
No, it is not just change for the sake of change. It is positive change. They want positive change.
Are they giving them that message?
Yes. Yes, we're giving them that message. Of course, you know that countries that have experienced the kind of conditions we have been living in have, in most part, had not so good change. We have had Somalia after Said Berry.
Please don't wish us that direction.
No,
God forbid.
But no, I don't. I can't wish it.
Don't even mention we could
get
ideas.
No, you are not going to get
mention
any ideas.
Tanzania, maybe.
No, but Tanzania is different.
Okay, Kenya.
Yes. So, but we are talking about countries that have had change after one leader leading for so many years. So we have had Mobutu, we have had Somalia, we have had recently Libya. In most of all those, the changes have been violent. But when you see the changes that they have had, or the leadership that has taken over immediately, did not really have much experience in governance.
So you so one of the transition
so,
that brings a bit of the old, merges it in with the new and the like.
Yes, I think, you know.
Even as you extrapolate that point, I have a caller on the line.
Okay.
Good evening, welcome to the show. Your brief question or comment after an introduction of who you are. Yes, I can hear you loud and clear. Your question, please.
Okay, good evening, Simon. How are you?
I'm great, yourself?
Yeah, my greetings to Ambassador Idi Sempala.
Your name, where you're calling from, and your brief question or comment.
Okay, I'm calling Nyombi Richard Maro, calling in from Muyenga right now. Okay, my question to Ambassador Idi Sempala. Myself, I've been an NRM cadre for close to 10 years, senior cadre the way, and I've worked with Honorable Amama Mbabazi for quite some time at the Secretariat. My question goes, why can't Honorable Amama Mbabazi decide to step down for retired Colonel Kizza Besigye, since the latter, that's Kizza Besigye, possesses masses of people and huge support among Ugandans? It would be better, because we are all vying for change. We all want change. People want change. Uganda wants change as a country. That's my question to Ambassador Idi Sempala.
Thank you, Nyombi. I would have loved to ask you a question, how you're able to substantiate that one has more supporters than the other before they go into a scientific process of actually us casting our votes. But we have another caller on the line. Good evening, welcome to the show. Good evening and welcome to the show. Your brief question or comment after an introduction of who you are. Oh, I'm sorry. We must have lost her on the line. But we have another caller on the line. Good evening and welcome to the show.
Hello.
Yes.
Good evening.
Great. Thanks for asking.
Hello.
I can hear you loud and clear. Your brief question or comment.
Yeah, my question is, hello?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, I have a simple question. What is that small thing that Mr. Mbabazi can account himself on for having achieved in this government that the Ugandans can count on him?
Your name and where you're calling from?
Sadat, calling from Lira.
Lira. Fresh from the euphoria of a rally that was there this afternoon. We have another caller on the line. Good evening and welcome to the show. Good evening. Did we just lose that other caller? Just a brief to the callers, please ensure that you've reduced the volume of your TV set so we don't get a lot of feedback, but also importantly, we can hear you loud and clear. Ask your question after introducing yourself. Good evening. Thank you very much.
I'm called my name is Eric from Chirwa District.
Yes.
We are really yearning for change. I'm from the president's district, but we're yearning for change. My question goes, Chirwa has been complaining that his elections were rigged. So how is Amama Mbaba going to protect his vote so that it's not rigged? Thank you very much.
Brilliant question. Thank you so much. How will Amama Mbabazi protect his vote? Another caller on the line before we can get down to answering these questions in an omnibus manner. Good evening and welcome to the show.
Good evening. Good evening, sir.
Your brief question or comment. Thanks for asking.
This is Musoke Henry from Kabowa.
Yes, Musoke Henry.
I'm asking, madam. Is there any possibility of these members like uniting at the end of this so that we can achieve the change you want, or there's no hope?
Did I get you right? Let's take that question again.
Like, is there any hope of Besigye and the Mbabazi uniting in that we get a single opposition candidate, or there's no hope?
Thank you very much for that question. He's asking whether indeed there is any glimmer of hope that your principal and the retired Colonel Kizza Besigye could possibly consider running as joint candidates or as having a joint candidate. We'll have another caller before we can answer these questions.
Hello?
Yes, so I can hear you loud and clear. Reduce the volume of your TV and then shoot with your next question.
Hello?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear. Your brief question or comment. I'm afraid we've lost that, and there was quite a bit of bad connection over there. Now, let's take these questions very quickly before we can let in another omnibus of callers. Nyombi does ask.
Hello, this is Engineer Jude Tadeo.
Oh, Jude, thanks for joining us. And sorry, Jude, I hadn't heard you until you mentioned your name. Come on, let's shoot.
Yes, what I'm saying, actually, I'm commenting about that lady, the information she's giving us now. Hello?
Yes, we can hear you. This is Ambassador Edith Sempala, not that lady.
Yeah, okay, that ambassador, actually. Even the thing I'm seeing that you're asking her some serious questions of why she's lying behind somebody who has been torturing people on his command, and she's not... She's not being clear to tell us why she's going beyond that. Instead, she's just meandering.
So thank you very much, Jude, for that observation. And I want to believe that Ambassador Edith Sempala will be concise, precise, and straight to the point. But you can't blame her much. That's what diplomats are taught to do. You can say so much without saying so much. Not so. That's the art of diplomacy.
No, really.
Well, Peter Nyobi does ask you... a similar question to the one that was asked by Musoke Henry. He asks why Amama, considering the huge support, according to him, that Kizza Besigye seems to have, doesn't cede it for him and support him so that we can see the change that we are clamoring for. And the question is almost re-echoed in similar vein by Musoke, who says, is there any hope that there could be some kind of unity?
Okay.
We'll start with that one.
Yeah, Simon, I think the approach of Right Honorable Amama Mbabazi and Dr. Besigye are somehow different. The message of Right Honorable Amama Mbabazi is peaceful transition, peaceful change.
So do I get it that therefore Kizza Besigye's message is possibly one of unpeaceful change?
Well, his message is more of
defiance.
And defiance can be interpreted in so many ways.
As rebellion.
It could, yes, as rebellion.
Uh-huh.
And rebellion could be, could involve bloodshed. So many people, therefore, are not really interested in bloodshed.
Or especially are you deliberately because, not understanding especially, Dr. Kizza's message of...
No, I know he has also talked about doing it peacefully. But if you are rebelling from a system that is also, that is entrenched and that is...
That is
resisting, then you could... I really don't understand his message very well either.
Let me just ask you something.
Yes, please.
Do you think Dr. Kizza Besigye is a violent man?
I don't know about whether he's a violent man.
I'm just saying, do you think he's a violent man? You've been around for some time. You've watched these guys. You have been awake to what happens in Uganda.
What I've seen comparing him with Amama Mbabazi mm-hmm. is that we saw, for instance, Amama Mbabazi trying to calm people down in Jinja
mm-hmm.
when the people were so annoyed with the police and they wanted to retaliate. He was calming them down. I've seen him in a number of places trying to calm people
Let's
down.
Let's use another example from yes. close to Jinja. You've seen Amama Mbabazi being stopped by the police,
yes.
asked to get out of an armored car, and yes. he gets out. And he's driven away in a police pickup.
Yes.
And I'm sure you've seen Kizza Besigye
yes.
stopped by the police. And we go back to what you saw.
Yes.
The breaking of the window. So yes. could it have been the police's fault? Or it's someone resisting lawful arrest that sometimes calls for what Newton calls for every action, there's sometimes an equal but opposite reaction.
Well, but I really don't believe that Dr. Besigye, I think Dr. Besigye is...
An aggressive guy.
Well, he's very aggressive.
Will
he's
he
very
be
aggressive.
At the risk of losing our viewers who ask their questions,
yes.
there's this question that came in from Lira.
Yes.
What is that small thing that Mbabazi can claim I did in the last 30 years I served President Museveni's government that I should show off and say, Ugandans, vote for me because I was able to do this small little thing and I can be bigger mm-hmm. and better if we go forward.
Do you remember when we had at they called it a regional war in the DRC. You remember that?
Mm-hmm.
He was assigned to actually moderate that.
And you think I think the ordinary guy watching us, indeed, like you saw from Chiruhura, from Mount Moroto, from somewhere in even Kanung, which is close mm-hmm. to the DRC, mm-hmm. or somewhere in Walukuba, in mm-hmm. Jinja,
mm-hmm.
really cares about what Uganda was doing in the DRC? For all they know, Ugandans were in there, perhaps not to pacify the place, but to loot. So they are looking at something that Mbabazi can lay claim to with regard to ameliorating the lives of ordinary Ugandans, that they can feel and touch and say, this is the legacy of Mama Mbabazi in all the years he served as President Museveni's close aide.
But you see, that was a test of ability to negotiate, to moderate,
mm-hmm.
And if one could do that, yes, I agree with you, not so many people know about it or even care about it because it looks like far removed. But what I want to assure you is that if somebody could disentangle a complex problem like that one, because that one was about to engulf us. Remember Uganda with Rwanda, and the rest of the countries.
So we can comfortably say that candidate mm-hmm. Amama Mbabazi has his grounding well firmed in terms of ameliorating regional and international relations.
Not only that, but that also means security.
for the country and the people.
Security for the country and for the people.
There is a question that came in from Chiruhura, the backyard of President Museveni, where this gentleman clearly says they are yearning for change.
Yes.
And he asks, how are you ready to safeguard your vote? Because clearly for Kizza Besigye, his vote has been stolen. According to the caller, how are you, with Go Forward, ready to safeguard your vote? And of course he knows that you know a little bit of what vote stealing means, if at all there was one, because you've been at the center of these elections that allegedly have stolen votes. So therefore you should not safeguard your vote.
Yes, yes.
In other words, it's more like send a thief to catch a thief.
Not really.
Am I being naughty?
Yes, you're being naughty. You're being naughty, Simon. I think the rigging has taken place mostly where the opposition has been weak. Because you see Kampala, because everybody is vigilant, because everybody is very interested. There has not been any rigging.
So in other words, have you created similar structures across the country?
Yes, we have. Yeah, we have structures all over the country. And we are telling our people, first and foremost, to turn up and vote. Because as you know, over 40% of Ugandans did not vote in the last election.
They are registered voters, but they don't vote.
Yes. So we are telling people to turn up and vote, but we are also telling people to remain behind and protect their vote, to follow it through. Yes.
That's a very important perspective.
Yes.
Look, let's take another set of callers before I can ask you whether beyond simply telling Ugandans to show up to vote, there's another incentive that you're putting on the table to bring on the table to ensure that people bring themselves to polling stations. Good evening. Welcome to the show and your brief question or comment.
Good evening, namesake. Simon Seremba here.
Yes, Simon.
I have two questions, Mr. Kaseyati.
Tell me.
Number one, Mr. Mbabazi has been on record that he does not believe in term limits. Has Mrs. Sempala there taken the trouble to ask him whether he believes in term limits or if she still believes
he's a nice guy
and does not have the courtesy to even ask her candidate what he actually believes and what he has done and said at cabinet meeting with other ministers? Two, Mr. Kasiat, in contrast to his competitor Besigye, Mr. Mbabazi is not on record ever to have contradicted his boss. On the other hand, his former colleague issued a paper against the regime, but Mbabazi waited until he was pushed out, until late last year. That gentleman had promised he will never stand against his boss. Isn't this a matter of revenge? I think that we should take the leadership of this country more seriously.
Thanks, Selemba, for eloquently putting across your two questions. Your next caller is online. Good evening and welcome to the show.
Hello. Hello, Simon.
Yes, speak a bit louder with a bit of more gusto.
Okay, hello, Simon.
Now I can hear you loud and clear. Shoot, your name, hello, question, Simon, and where you're calling from.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
Yes, I am Richard. I'm calling from Nadia.
In Zambia.
In Zambia.
Hello?
Yes. I'm losing you. Can you speak with a bit of energy? I know it's about dinner time. Have you had your dinner? Let's speak very strongly. I'm afraid the line is not clear. I can hardly get to you. Maybe we have someone else on the line. Good evening and welcome to the show. Good evening and welcome to the show.
Good evening. My name is Anthony Rutu. I'm here in Arua.
Yes, Anthony in Arua.
Yes, I wanted to thank the doctor for those issues. But I wish they can tell us more about what is going to be done in issues to do with education and more to do with health.
Thank you very much, Antonia, and for clarity's sake, Ambassador Edith Sempala is not a doctor, or so she told me when we met at the beginning of this show. Edith, questions are coming in fast and furious. Simon Seremba is asking, your principal is on record.
Yes.
For two things. One, never to contradict his boss. He, in fact, at one time said he would never contest the presidency if President Museveni were a candidate. Secondly, he believes in no term limits. What's the chance that if we make Amman Mbabazi president 2016, we won't be grappling with removing Amman Mbabazi in 2032?
Thank you very much, Simon, for those, I think, pertinent questions. Term limits. We are all interested in reinstating term limits.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Say that again?
Yes.
And this is the go-forward position?
Yes, this is the go-forward position.
I would look in the face and say, you believe in reinstating term limits?
Yes.
So what was he doing when he was leading a couple of members of parliament?
Let me tell you first.
To scrap.
First and foremost, as you very well know, Simon, that not every democratic country has term limits.
Yes, of course.
The UK, for instance.
France.
Yes, France, Germany. But they have checks and balances. They have systems which do not allow
incumbency to be entrenched.
To rig and also to rig. So, therefore, I think many of us, including myself, as a matter of fact, I didn't care so much about term limits. Maybe because I believed President Museveni could not be involved in rigging or could not actually go back to his word when he said that the problem of Africa is leaders who overstay in power.
You know, I believe President Museveni recently said he's afraid you go forward and Mbabazi and Kizza Besigye are out to steal his vote.
Okay.
He's worried.
That is very interesting. I saw it actually in Ruwero with Nabu Kenya.
And so, in other words, you're saying that the term limits will be reinstated because the process of putting across certain amenities and checks and balances is certainly a little bit far off the radar.
Yes.
What about this whole never contradicting his boss, always the guy that supported his boss's position, in fact saying you never stand in President Museveni is a contender in an election, and Simon is asking, isn't this a revenge kind of thing? You fired me, let me show you who is boss.
No, it is not a revenge. I believe that as a matter of fact, if it was possible, they would have competed. So it was not necessary, actually, to go independent. Mm. If they had competed and President Museveni emerged victorious, he would not have stood. But when you have a situation, Simon, whereby competition is forbidden, and it is even punished. What do you do? What do you do when you believe in something when your president is moving in a completely different direction?
You go forward.
You go forward.
Now, let's look at Anthony's concern here. He's asking, well, you have mentioned all these feel-good, nice things.
Mm-hmm.
You've also gone ahead to articulate the problems in the health sector, in education sector, and all that. But he wants to know a little bit of more meat. What is it that you are putting on the table? President Museveni, at some campaigns back, did say free education for all, UPE, USE, and the like.
Mm-hmm.
The other day he said, I will bring down health center facilities up to the lowest level of society, which is the village. What are you putting on the table as go forward in education and in health, specifically to his question?
The quality of education. If I look at my school, Namtamba Demonstration School, it was producing students to Gayaza, to Budo, to all these places. As I speak today, it's no longer a demonstration school because the TTC, the Teacher Training College that was attached to us, is dead. So we therefore need quality education. It's not enough to have numbers.
But it's better but to it, have it, the quality.
And no, the it is not that only is better to have quality. You can have quality, quantity and quality at the same time.
And the question that it begs is, mm-hmm. how will you do it? Please don't refer me to the manifesto. For this one, articulate it here.
No, I think Uganda is not
pay a poor... teachers better give them $1 million each.
Simon, Uganda is not a poor country. But money has been is mismanaged. Corruption, bribery, and all the likes. So if that money is saved, it can go into, yes, paying teachers better, motivating them better, improving the facilities for education, and therefore upgrading the level of education.
You know, it's easy for people to harp this corruption thing and make it seem like President Museveni is not doing a lot to fight corruption. I mean, mm-hmm. what we know for a fact is there are institutions in this country that are anti-corruption agencies, IGG, DPP, there's a whole committee of parliament about that. There's a state house department, I'm sure, about that. There's an anti-corruption court and all this. The question is, how does your candidate intend to use these institutions in place and even bite even harder to create that zero tolerance you're talking about corruption?
Hello?
Today, when somebody is convicted of corruption, they get away with everything. They can just retire and go and enjoy their loot after maybe 2, 3, 4 years in prison.
Some are not even lucky enough to go to courts of law. They are defended by the system and they said, this is a clean man, don't touch him, you are persecuting him politically.
No. Mm. But as you know, I think you are referring to Mbabazi once again. But we also know that actually his cases, all the cases, have been investigated and he has been exonerated. Therefore, it is not right, Simon, mm-hmm. for you to keep on insinuating that and insisting that actually, and giving an impression that actually he was just defended. We know that it is on record. He has been investigated and he has been found not guilty.
If somebody
is not guilty, they are not guilty.
Certainly.
Yes.
As we conclude this program, Ambassador Edith Sempala, of course the campaign trail is still young. You still have the whole month of November. You're going into December. There will be January. That will be crunch time. And then the home run for the first 15 days of February next year. What is the outlook?
The outlook looks extremely good. It looks extremely good because people are yearning for change. We were in Ruel today, and I mean the signs were clearly on the wall. People want change, and the conditions are forcing them to want change.
What is giving you that sense of belief? Is it the crowds? Because now I understand it's a campaign of crowds, clouds, and sometimes clowns. So what do the crowds tell you? Are they real supporters or curious onlookers? Are they real crowds of supporters, organic as you want to call them, or they are simply people who would gather around me if I had a show on the street in Kasarawe? How would you read the crowds as we conclude?
Let me just bring back our first after nomination rally in Nachivubo. First and foremost, the weather was horrible. It was raining. It poured on us. There is no, as I know Ugandans, even when it is raining, they don't go to work. So people who were standing there were clearly interested. They were invested. They want change so badly that they could bear that rough. The rain, the sewage. We even had sewage.
Quickly pick the drift ambassador.
So therefore, on our rallies, I cannot speak about the other rallies, but on our rallies, people bring themselves. People, you can see, and we also, you know, some of us go around and take interest to hear people's stories and hear the people's Why are they coming to the rally? What do they hope to get? What is motivating them? And what is very clear, Simon, is that people want change, and but they also want peaceful change.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Edith Sempala, for gracing this program. And of course, like the other robber to the right side of the Messiah on that fateful Friday on the mount, on that mount where they were crucified, turned to him and said, remember me when you get to your kingdom. And this I'm speaking on behalf of we in the press corps, who for the most part seem to be fodder for the political elite. When they assume office, we begin to be labeled all sorts of things. And so we are hoping that your government, when it comes into power, or if it does, it certainly does not involve itself in muzzling our space of free speech and the ability to inform the nation. For you, our viewers that grace these programs with your presence and your contribution, we are eternally grateful, and we thank you for keeping a keen interest in how and how we debate these issues and how we bring them to you. And of course, speaking that information that will help you make that decisive decision when you are between yourself and the ballot paper. We'll keep you with more informative insights in the goings-on of the political scene. It's On The Spot. We'll meet same time, same place on Thursday with yet another insightful look at the issue at hand. Good evening and God bless.